Record and I'm not going to mute you guys just in case you have something to add here, but basically I'm going to try to keep this to 30 minutes, so I want us to be done by 9 if we can, just out of respect for everybody's time. I think what I'm going to do is just kind of give a little intro, and then we could just kind of briefly go by chapter, because he was really good about introducing each chapter. If there's something that you guys want to share, or you had a nugget of wisdom that you wanted to add to it, feel free to chime in, and we can just go from there and kind of chat about that. Does that sound good to everybody?
Sounds great.
Perfect. Okay. So I want to start by saying I've begun a little bit of an obsession with John Maxwell. Jenny gave us a devotional of John Maxwell's it's like a year-long devotional with John Maxwell, each day something different. And it's been really amazing. And so it's been really awesome for me. I'm super excited about it. But in chapter one, he talks about starting with yourself, which to me is huge. I think that finding yourself and checking yourself for leadership skills and checking yourself for the qualities that you feel like you want to possess, not only in your leadership life, but in your everyday life, I thought was really big. He said to first take the time to focus on yourself, and you'll soon be able to win others and influence others. You can't be happy without being healthy. And he talked about wellness, and that I felt like that really spoke to us with our company, because that's what Plexus is it is a wellness company, which I thought was really great. He talked about you can't give what you don't have, that you'll only be able to take a person as far as you have gone yourself. And to me, that I was thinking about in terms of our teams and things like that. If you haven't gone a certain level, if you haven't grown yourself personally, how can you continue to help other people grow as well? I was talking with my husband the other day about this very thing, that to me, this has been the one thing in my whole life that I haven't really, and this is a gut check for me, but this has been a one thing in my life that has been it's been hard for me. It hasn't come easy. Everything else in my life, if I tried it, I was pretty good at it. It wasn't that hard. I mean, I worked at it. Obviously I'm a super competitive person, so I always work really hard at what I do, but I will tell you, this is the very first thing that I haven't immediately been really good at. And that's super frustrating for me. And so he talks about building yourself and growing yourself. And that to me, that's really huge. And so that spoke to me a lot, especially in the first chapter when it talks about that you can't help other people grow until you're ready to grow yourself, and until you actually are growing and building yourself into a better leader. He talks about that you can't give what you don't have, that you'll only be able to take a person. I said that, sorry. You can't enjoy others until you enjoy yourself, that you can't encourage others to be winners if you aren't really a winner yourself. And to me, that means that it's not about being a winner, because he talked about how to win, be a winner, always be a winner. But being a winner is accepting yourself for who God made you to be. And to me, I identify with that quite a bit, that being comfortable in my own skin, and that makes me a natural leader. And it also makes me a winner in my life, because I'm accepting of who I am. You can't encourage others to be winners if you aren't a winner. This means you need to be comfortable with yourself and believe in yourself in order to motivate others, and that your value is more important than all of the other things that you think are important in your life. That when you embrace your own personal value, when you're secure in who you are, you're a winner. That chapter one was very, very big for me. I was very moved by that. I kind of got teary-eyed a couple of times, just because of some things that I feel like I'm trying to better for myself. I'll open up before I move on to chapter two. Does anybody have anything that they wanted to share? Y'all good? He also talked about value and valuing yourself, that he talked about recognizing your value, accepting your value, increasing your value, and believing in your value. I don't know if you guys got to that part or you took notes on that. I love that all of those things, those are ways to value yourself, that you have to recognize it first and recognize that you actually have value. And that you have to accept it, that everybody has insecurities in their life. We're not saying that you're going to be perfect, but having recognizing that you still have value despite your insecurities. And then to increase your value, that recognize that you're loved by God. Recognize that you have problems, you have issues, talked about issues, and that you have issues that you might need to solve, and that's okay, and that you might have things that you need to work on with your own personal life, and that's totally okay too. Believe in your value, believe it with such conviction that you would be willing to bank on it. And that really spoke home for me too lately, just for some things that we're trying to decide as a family. I have to believe in this so much that I do have to bank on this, that this is, if this is the next step in our lives, I have to be able to believe so strongly that this is what we're moving towards. And I, you know, if this was my only job, Megan, you could speak on that, like with Chad and stuff. You guys believed in this enough to bank on that and let him continue doing what he's doing with Maggie, which to me is, that's a huge step of faith to me. I feel like that is.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll just go ahead and chime in. It is a huge step of faith, and it's, I'm not going to say it's easy every day, but I know it's right. I've never seen him happier. And to have a husband that wants to stay home with his daughters, I don't know. I think I'm pretty darn lucky. One thing I kind of took note of on believing in your value, and I think it's so important, especially as we head into convention, you're going to meet a lot of people, and people will introduce themselves with their rank. I would challenge you to watch yourself to not say, oh, I'm just silver or I'm just gold. That's a big deal. There are so many people in this company that have just joined or are just an ambassador and, you know, have a customer. So where you are is valuable. So that's one thing that I, you know, yes, I'm an emerald, but I, on a very big level, I struggle with my confidence around all of these other incredibly successful women. So I would just challenge you to treat yourself like a diamond. Treat yourself and present yourself like you are a diamond. So that's kind of my little takeaway from that. Or a double diamond, you know, why not?
You know, whatever. Well, and he talked about that later. I think I took some notes about that too, but I have always, and it was funny because we were driving to the grocery store this afternoon, and that Tim McGraw song, Humble and Kind, came on. I don't know if y'all know that song, but that is how I want my children to be. And I could seriously, I get teary real fast about that. But I want my children to be humble and kind. And I want them to say please and thank you and hold the door for people. And to me, that's more important than any amount of money that they're ever going to make. It's more important to me than any rank we could ever advance to. But to show humility to others and kindness to others. And man, we are in Vegas, and it is the place where people, it's the city of excess. And I've never been that kind of person. And so to come to a place like that and remain humble and introduce yourself because you're you. Not because you're silver, not because you're gold, not because you're diamond. You are Megan. You are Maggie's mom. What are the most important attributes of who you are as a person, as opposed to who we are necessarily in this company? It's important, and I don't negate that at all. But I feel like for me as a person, I would be remiss if I said I would be coming to convention and saying, you know, hey, I'm Angie and I'm Senior Ruby, la, la, la. You know, if you ask me, I'll tell you my rank, but there's a real good chance I'm just going to tell you who I am. Maggie! Look at her smile. Hi! Oh my gosh, she's so cute. Okay, like I said, I'm going to keep this call short, so let me go on. Okay, so chapter 2, I love the 30-second rule. As a teacher, oh my gosh, that hit home for me because I thought, oh crap, what am I doing with my kids? I am not encouraging them, and I am not always saying something positive to them when I first see them at the beginning of the day. And I thought, how much would that change their day if I was kind to them and showed them a little bit more grace, I think is the right word. But he said that within 30 seconds of a conversation with someone, say something encouraging to them. And people everywhere need a good word and a compliment to fire their hopes and dreams, make others look good. Lee, and I love the ergograph example of actual students and kids, and whenever they were encouraged, that they actually had more energy and they got less tired if they were tired, or if they were they didn't get a good word and they were still tired, then that you could see that they got even more tired. And that was, I spoke to me as a teacher. Sorry, my dog's over here too. To become an, yep, there she is. To become an energy carrier. We just have all kinds of animals and babies all over here. To become an energy carrier, that was huge. And I thought, how, what is the energy that I give off as a, just as a human in my everyday life? Is it something that is a positive thing, or am I generally kind of a negative person? I usually feel like I'm a positive person, but I know there are times when I get in that funk and it's hard. And I think even if I just said one little nice thing to somebody, it sure would change their day, because they may be having a bad day too. This instills motivation, and everyone needs it, and it helps you too. And I agree with that 100%, that if I give a good word to somebody, it means 10 times more to me than if anybody ever said anything nice to me. I would much prefer to give out those compliments than receive them. I'm actually a really horrible gracious. I'm not a gracious receiver when it comes to compliments and gifts. So, I prefer to be able to give them out, which is great. To forget about searching for ways to make yourself look good and focus on ways to make others look good. And his three A's, the triple A approach, he said, attention, affirmation, and appreciation. Okay. Anybody else have anything on chapter two that they wanted to share? Y'all do?
You kind of said exactly what I was thinking. I read a book earlier this year called The Energy Bus. And the one thing that kind of was very much in line with what he was talking about was, and you touched exactly on it, but everybody has an energy. Just what kind is it? So what kind are you bringing to the table?
Yeah. Okay, chapter three. To let people know that you need them. And I will tell you again, it's like every chapter hit home. I was like, oh man, that was so good. Oh, that hits my heart. Oh, that hits my heart. And I will tell you, this one was even worse, because I am the worst about asking for help. I am an only child, extremely independent person. I don't need help. I don't ask for help. I'm a strong woman. I was single for 6 years. I am woman, hear me roar kind of thing. I don't like to ask for help. Thank you, Grace. Sorry. that whole I can do it without you mentality was absolutely my mentality. And I think that this chapter and this business is helping me realize this is a group effort. This is a team effort, 100% all the way. And if you can't embrace that team atmosphere, it's going to be hard for you to succeed. You know, why is Celeste as good as she is? Because she has an amazing team. She knows amazing people. Hi, Chad. She has amazing friends, and she put her amazing friends on her team. And that's exactly why she's as successful as she is. And she would tell you that, because she has an amazing team. Leaders can only become great when they realize they need others. I'm sorry, I'm wrestling with my dog. When the vision gets bigger than you, you have two choices. And that's to give up the vision or to get help. And that's big, you know, because I think so many people, you get stuck at silver, you get stuck at gold, you get stuck wherever you're stuck. I mean, I've been at Senior Ruby for 18 months, and I could be at that point where I say, either we're going to give up or I'm going to have to, you know, get help. And so I did. I've gotten help, and I think my team is growing back up. Obviously, I'm kind of rebuilding the whole thing. And I'm okay with that. And it says, no matter how accomplished and successful you are, you do need people, and you can't win without them. You can't succeed without others in your life. Enlist people's hands and hearts too. And I love that you enlist them, like on your team page, start getting some of your runners to help post every day or every other day, or they're in charge of whatever it is. Like, tomorrow night we have a team Zoom call, and we have some nurses on our team, and they've been doing the triplex. So they went over the like last week they started with ProBio, and tomorrow they're talking about BioCleanse, and then the next week they end with the Slim. And so instead of me doing it, they're really the health experts. So they're doing that. I shouldn't have, me and my friend Tina, who are a part of we're kind of partners on this with the page. We shouldn't have to be the ones that do the Zoom calls, the team calls all the time, but to enlist people's hands and then their hearts too, that like Celeste had posted her little list of all the Senior Rubies that she's praying for and encouraging. And I think that's good. And that's probably why we really love this company, is because everybody is so encouraging, and everybody's so willing to link arms together and help each other out, even if you're not on the same team, which is good. Everyone likes to be an expert. So that increased sense of self-worth, again, with the Zoom call that I did, I thought that for tomorrow night, I think it's last week's was really great and this week will be no different. You can do a better job with the help from others than you can do on your own. And good leaders make others feel that they are at the very heart of things, that they're not at the peripheral, that they're actually in the middle and at the heart of it, what you're doing. And it gives their work meaning. And so if you can give them meaning and you can give them value, that's going to change everything. Everyone feels that they can contribute to the success of the organization, which to me is great too. To forget about a prideful attitude that causes you to prove how capable you are without the help of others. That was hard for me to read. I don't know about y'all, but that was hard for me to read, that just because I can do it on my own doesn't mean I should do it on my own. And just because I have the capabilities to do everything myself doesn't mean I should do everything myself. That, you know, I think that's why we're supposed to go through life with other people around us, be it a spouse, be it a friend, be it your family, be it children, parents, whatever it is. I don't think you're meant to live your life alone. And I think that regardless of who's in your life, that's why we have people around us. And and then that question, if you can do a better job than me, is great. Like the whole thing about asking some of my teammates to help with Zoom calls is huge. You know, they know better than I do, so why not let them do it? Does anybody have anything on chapter 3?
Hey, Ange.
Yeah.
I have to tell you from my aspect, part of it for me, because this has definitely been a good book, but I don't trust, right? It's letting go and trusting people. And you know, obviously we've all had issues in our past, but trusting people, whether it's teammate or not teammate, you know, or your downline or not, it's trusting them to actually accomplish it. And it may not be to the level you would do it, but know that it's good and it's good enough.
Yeah.
And that's a hard thing to get over.
I think that's hard as a parent too. You know, it's like loading the dishwasher today. My 8-year-old, I was like, there's so much more room, but I thought, you know what? She needs to learn to do it. And it's okay. So that giving up control is very hard for me too, because I'm kind of a control freak. So yeah.
Well, and like you, I was used to doing it myself for so many years. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not an only child, but I'm independent and I've done it myself. And I was single mom for so many years and I'll get it done.
Yep.
Exactly. As my husband said, he loves me because I don't need him. I want him, but I don't need him.
Yeah. And I think that's reciprocal too. It's, I'm grateful to have another human in my life that doesn't need me. Another adult human. Obviously the kids do, but another adult human that doesn't need me. Yeah. Okay, chapter 4, create a memory and visit it often. Few things bond people together more than a shared memory. And he talks about you can't just expect memories to spontaneously happen. And I think that's hard for me because a lot of times they do. And those are the best ones to me, is that spontaneously happen. I'm a planner, but when it comes to those memories, so many of the memories that I have in my life are not, they are spontaneous. They're not planned. But he talks about to make something happen, that if we're intentional, we can make something happen. He talks about setting aside some time to make something happen, and that if we don't carve out the time, we may never create that memory. This was important to me when we talk about convention and how busy it's going to be and how crazy insane this place is going to be, and that it's going to be very important for you to make time for your team and to make sure that you say, okay, you know, Monday night, we're going to have our team dinner, and make sure that you show those people how valued they are, because if you don't, there's a chance you could never see them. A friend of mine, Amy, has made reservations for a couple of lunches throughout the week because it's so busy. I think especially that Monday and Tuesday she made lunch reservations, and she was like, do you want to come? And I said, well, let me ask my team and see how many people they would be. But I thought, she's so right that if we're not careful, we're never going to see people that we know because it's so big and so busy. He talked about planning for something to happen and to find a way to make something happen and show that something happened afterwards. So take pictures and create those memories for everybody to remember too. So you take pictures, and everybody's really great about Facebook, so you put it on there for convention and then send it to those people that were in those pictures. And then he also talks about to relive that memory and maybe send a note. And I thought, how cool would that be to write little notes to your team before you actually even leave convention and mail them while you're in Vegas, or even if you mail them when you get home, but you could remember whatever happened for that day and write a little note to them and then put it in your suitcase, and you could even mail it after you get home so that they get it later and they're encouraged later, like, oh, that was so great. Wasn't that great when we did this, or, you know, whatever. I thought that was kind of cool. Okay, that's all I had for four. I think I stopped taking so many notes. I had like pages, and then I sort of slowed down a little bit. Does anybody have anything for four? Good? Okay. Okay. So chapter five, that compliment people in front of other people. When you affirm their dreams, they make the dreams become more real than their doubts. So you encourage people, and that's going to help them to make their dreams become way more real to them than the doubts that they ever had. People want to feel worthwhile in life, that Mary Kay Ash said, to make people feel important. That was one of her biggest mantras, was to make people feel important. And compliments affirm people and make them strong. Affirmation is a statement you make firm in another person's heart. I think that complimenting people, sometimes I'm really good at it and other times I'm not. I think a lot of compliments in my head and I don't say them out loud to people. And that's hard for me to take, because I think of myself as a positive person, but I feel like I could be better about that and I could compliment them more. The other day in the Chick-fil-A line, I gave the little girl, she was standing outside where, you know, when it's really busy, she was standing outside taking the order, and she had the most beautiful eyes. They were not hazel and not green and not brown, but they were gorgeous. And I told her they were gorgeous and I thought she was going to drop her pen. It was so cute. She was like, thank you so much. That was the sweetest thing I've heard all week. And I thought, you know, this little girl stands out here every day and probably deals with such crap heads that, you know, treat her horrible and are griping at her because her chicken nuggets aren't right or whatever it is. And I thought, you know, and I just said it, and I thought, and I remember driving off thinking, I really need to do better about that. I need to do that more. I need to be more more complimentary to people. It's, to me, it's huge.
One thing on that, for me, and maybe this is just me, but I almost find it easier to compliment people I don't know. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, confession, it's a pride thing. You don't want people you know to think, you know what I mean? I guess I think it's a pride thing and I can't explain why, but it's easier just to tell people you don't know, oh my God, you look gorgeous, or,
right,
you know, because you feel like it's almost a ding against yourself when it's someone you do life with, but it's not at all.
Well, and I feel like sometimes they feel like they need to say something back to me. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I am not a gracious receiver when it comes to compliments and gifts. I am really bad about it. I deflect. I am the queen of deflection. You know, it's like, oh, your hair looks real good today. And I'll make a joke. Oh yeah, well, washed it this week. Or, you know, something stupid. And I shouldn't do that. I should just say thank you. And I know I need to work on it, and I'm not good about that. And I think that for me, when I compliment people I know, I feel like they think I expect them to say something back, and I really don't. I would rather them not say anything back, actually. So that's, at least for me, I totally get that though. And I love that when he talked about that compliments in front of others are the most effective ones you can give. That there is no downside. It's all, if you are always sincere, that it will always be a positive response, that people, you give a public compliment, people can't, they're not going to be negative about it. There's no negative point to it. Anybody have anything for that? Okay. I'll move on to chapter 6. Give others a reputation to uphold. And he talked about Winston Churchill and motivating the English people. He gave the English people a reputation to uphold. He inspired them, motivated them, and challenged them. So, like you talked about earlier, Megan, even if you're not, if you're silver and you're like, I'm just silver, you're like, no, heck no, I've got the best silver team in the whole company, or I've got, you know, the best this company in the whole company. These people, they're going to be motivated by you, and they're going to be motivated by your encouragement and the what you say to them about the reputation of your team. That if you uphold that reputation, it'll start to stick, and it'll help people to step up to that game. And he talks about what is special and unique and wonderful about this person, and to always think the best of others. And I'm kind of a Pollyanna with that. I'm not really a glass half empty girl. I'm usually glasses half full, and I always think the best, and I'm probably too trusting of others when it comes to thinking that they're nice and thinking that they're kind. And like Jason and I talk about friends of ours from high school, and I'm like, he did what? I thought they were dating for like a year and a half. And he's like, he dated like 4 or 5 girls. I was like, shut up. And I never would have thought that, because I just thought he was, you know, he's 17-year-old boy. He's faithful. He's stuck with that one little girl. Yeah, right, Ange, you're a dummy. But I am very, when it comes to that kind of thing, I'm very trusting. When it comes to that kind of stuff, I'm very trusting. I always assume the best of everybody. One of the best ways to inspire others and motivate them is to show them who they could be. And so you encourage them by this. And there was a couple of threads, I don't know if you were on some of these pages, Megan, but they talk about showing your rank announcements. So like in May, you go through all the people that are close or that what's their next advancement, and you show them their rank advancement announcement, and you go ahead and make it for them at the beginning of the month, and you say, this is your next thing, you know, and be excited for them, and that gives them something to be motivated for. Especially May could be huge for everybody because it's right before convention and everybody wants to be a certain rank by convention and all that. That would be, I think that would be huge and be so exciting for the team. And I'm definitely planning on doing that. That you play like world champions. When you give someone a reputation to uphold, you give them something good to shoot for. And it's putting something that was beyond their reach within their grasp, which, again, with the whole rank advancement announcement pictures, that could really motivate somebody to see that picture. They could put it as their screensaver or something and look at it. By speaking to their potential, you are asking them to play proud. Is that what he said? That doesn't sound right. People will go farther than they think they could go when someone they respect tells them they can. So somebody you respect is saying, girl, you've got this. You can totally do this. I believe in you. I want to see you in Hawaii, or I want to see you with that Lexus, whatever it is. Someone tells you that, that's huge. That's huge. And I will brag on Jason for a minute. He's sitting right here. I will brag on him for a minute because we were talking the other night about this kind of stuff, and he gave me a compliment he's like, I believe in you, and I really believe in this business for you, and I'm proud of you for the work that you're doing. And I thought, holy cow. And that kind of lit a fire under me, because he doesn't dole out compliments right and left. And to me, it spoke to my heart very, very much. That you always have a high opinion of people, that people perform consistently as you expect them to perform. So if you expect them to do the work, they'll eventually do it. It may take a little bit, but eventually they're going to step up to that game. They're like, well, gosh, everybody else is going to do it. Back up your high opinions with action. So you've got some high opinions, so make sure that you really back that up. Give them some significant responsibility, which, again, talked about that, Heather, with trusting people doing the thing to make sure that it's done right. And then it says, nothing gives people confidence like seeing someone they respect put their money where their mouth is. To look past their past, give them reputations towards their future. So look past those failures. Look past the people who you thought they were and look towards the future of who they would like to become. Give people a name or a new name that speaks to their potential. And you talked about the tennis coach that gave the really slow guy Speedy or flash or whatever it was. That was kind of funny. But seeing their potential, you know, to see their rock star and call them the, you know, you see the shirts where it says diamond in the making or future diamond and that kind of thing. I think that's, sometimes people really are encouraged by that kind of thing. Does anybody have anything on six?
One kind of, I guess it is a Plexus related story. When I was at Leaders Retreat in 2013, it was about a month after I got married, and Chad couldn't come because he was working. So I remember going to, it was like the little reception they had on the first night, and was meeting people, like was meeting Jen Hawkins and, you know, all of these super high ranking people. And Jen asked me, she's like, well, where's your husband? And I told her, and she's like, well, make sure he gets off for Hawaii. I was gold at this time. Wow. And that just stuck with me. And I made it happen. I don't know how. I mean, obviously it was my amazing team, but that completely stuck with me. And so words are incredibly powerful.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And then chapter 7, that's a great segue, Megan, because chapter 7 talks about saying the right words at the right time, and saying the right words is not enough. Timing is everything. And sometimes the best policy is to remain silent. And I think maybe the Lord was trying to tell me to keep my mouth shut sometimes, because I am known for what you see is what you get. And if you're curious about what I'm thinking, I'm probably going to end up telling you. I don't tend to mince words. I don't tend to shy away from telling you my opinion. And I think sometimes I need to remind myself that God gave me two ears and one mouth, and I should probably be listening twice as much as I speak, because sometimes I speak too much. To be sensitive to time and place, to pay attention to the context. And then if you can be sensitive to the setting, you've won half the battle. And so to be very aware of your surroundings and be aware of how that person is reacting and how their day's going, or just everything surrounding, you know, that mommy that's juggling things at the grocery store, and she's got four kids towed behind her, and, you know, she's in line. That's not the time to probably tell her to hurry up. It's the time to be encouraging and gracious and pick up her keys when she drops them or whatever, you know. I don't know. That's an example I could give. But I think to be aware of everything surrounding, you just don't know. And, you know, you talk about, I'm sure Megan has been, you've seen those times. We've all seen it at different Plexus events and these big high-ranking people. I think sometimes they're completely overwhelmed by the paparazzi, for better, lack of a better word, like these people that are starstruck. And I think that's overwhelming to me, because I don't know how I would handle it. I think I would not handle it very well, because I don't like people up in my face like that. But sometimes I feel like the right time and place to approach somebody is, you need to be sensitive to that, especially with some of these high ranking women and men that are almost superstars in our company. It's hard for, I can only imagine that it would be very hard for them, because I can't even imagine. I don't know. To say it from the heart, how you say it is huge. We talk about that in my family, because I have a preteen 11-year-old who, she will say stuff and I think, that was so nasty. And she goes, what, mom? I just said okay. But it's how you said okay. And that's big. How you say things makes all the difference in the world. People can tell the difference between hollow words and something that comes from your heart. And I think that's absolutely true. Look for opportunities to uplift others with your words. It just might change their lives. And I never have ever really thought that my words would change somebody's life. But what if it did? What if it did change somebody's life, even in a small way? That would be amazing. That would be really amazing. Forget about what you want to say and focus on what the other person needs to hear. And that whole listening twice as much as you talk, I think that's really important, because I think sometimes people, they're already forming their answer while you're talking, and then you kind of miss the point. And I think that's, you got to listen to what they're saying. What would you want to hear if you were in this other person's shoes? And then change someone's day or life by saying the right words at the right time. So that's all I had for 7. I stopped at 7 because chapter 8 began at 45 minutes and 14 seconds. So I figured next week we could start at chapter 8. That was a perfect spot. Does anybody have anything they want to finish up with? I know I went through that kind of fast, but I promised 30 minutes, so make it short and sweet. Awesome. Well, thanks for coming on here, guys. I think I had two links.
Salsa.
Guacamole. Guacamole.
Jason just talked about that. He goes, we need to send it to him. I was like, they live in Euless. We could probably do it.
Salsa, please.
We'll get you some. All right, y'all. I'm going to stop the recording. That was definitely on the recording.